Please stand and join me as we read responsibly our call to worship. It's found in your order of worship.
We have gathered to bear witness to the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the entry of his servant, Rich Obenschain, into eternal life. Let us rejoice in his presence with us, in death as in life, among those who mourn as with those who now see him face to face. We will praise Jesus Christ, because his victory is our victory. Please be seated.
We want to welcome you to this afternoon, to this celebration of life, to our dear friend and family member, Richard Obenschain. It is our desire that you leave here remembering a life well spent, but even more so. Remember, and let us remember and celebrate the Lord Rich so faithfully served. Let us pray.
Our God, you are the creator of the universe, our life sustainer in this life and the next. We look to you as our good shepherd and king. As we come to celebrate Rich's life, we confess the gospel that so transformed him, that you sent your beloved son into the world to live the life we each have failed to live, that you asked him to carry our heavy load, the weight of sin, to the cross, that he died and rose again, demonstrating victory over sin and death forever. And because of this gospel, we are the happiest of people. Even as we grieve deeply for a husband, a father, a brother, and a dearest friend, we have hope and a future. We know that Rich is at home with you even now, and we wait for the renewal of all creation when Christ comes again in glory. As we remember Rich's legacy today, we pray that you would help us to follow his example as he followed Jesus. Make us faithful people. Help us to steward your creation. Make us brave to join in what you are doing. Cause us to serve others with compassion and humility. Embolden us to hold fast to you, even as you hold us fast through what Christ has already done. And oh, how we love your son, Jesus. May he receive all honor and glory and praise in our worship today. If there are those who do not yet know you, we pray that they would behold your goodness and your beauty through Rich's life, even today. And we pray in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Would you please stand as we join together in singing "And Can It Be"? You'll find the sheet music in the back of your bulletin.
Thank you. Scripture is found in Isaiah 40, beginning on verse 28. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
Thank you. second scripture reading is from Psalm 121. I lift my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade on your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Our third reading is from Revelation chapter 21. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them. They will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. For the former things have passed away." And he who was seated on the throne said, "Behold, I'm making all things new." And he said, "Write this down. These words are trustworthy and true." May God bless the reading of his word.
Let's stand again and worship our Lord, the God of Abraham. Praise.
Thank you.
If you've spent any time around Rich or the Levita staff, chances are you've heard three phrases repeated quite often. You could probably say them if I asked you to right now. Be here now. Anyone on their cell phone right now? Commitment move. What's the other one? Hold fast. We've seen it on t-shirts. We've heard Rich say it many times. I've heard Abby and the Levita staff say it so well. Teach others those phrases. But today, I want to look at that phrase, hold fast, as we celebrate Rich's life. The phrase comes from Joshua 22, verse 5, where, as Rich liked to say, after the children of Israel had completed the longest camping trip ever recorded and were ready to go to the promised land, Joshua gave them this charge: but be very careful to keep the commandment and the law that Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave you, to love the Lord your God and walk in obedience to him, to keep his commands, to hold fast to him, and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul. Many years ago, Rich read that verse, and that phrase, hold fast, grabbed him. Not long after that, Rich had a very memorable conversation with our very own Dr. Marv Wilson. And the phrase, hold fast, quickly became the cornerstone of Rich's life and ministry. Catherine told me that after a conversation that Rich had with Marv, he came home so excited he could hardly contain himself. I talked with Marv last week about that conversation, and then he shared some insights with me about that beautiful Hebrew word, devak, hold fast. After talking with Marv, I realized why Rich came home so excited. Marv shared with me that holding fast to God is considered by many traditional Jews to be the most important command in all of Scripture. The Hebrew word devak is used to describe physical objects like your tongue sticking to the roof of your mouth, or even bones sticking to skin. It's also used figuratively of two people sticking close to each other in relationships, such as Genesis 2:24 describes in the relationship between a husband and a wife. The concept of holding fast is even carried into modern Hebrew, and the word for glue today in Hebrew is still debak. In Joshua's farewell words to Israel, he tells them to hold fast to the Lord. And this is a reminder to stay close to God and worship him alone. To hold fast is a reminder to the Israelites to never pursue false gods. Don't be tempted by them. Don't be drawn away by them. Don't let it break the glue that holds your relationship with God together. To pursue God alone, to serve him exclusively with their entire being. God calls his people to hold fast to him in love and loyalty. In the Bible, holding fast is not an optional matter. It's not if we cling to God, but how we cling to God in all things. Rich understood this and lived the life of holding fast to God well. Holding fast in Scripture also works the other way. We hold fast to God, and at the same time, God is holding fast to us. Holding fast describes the reciprocal love between God and his children. We hold fast to God, always trusting that he is holding fast to us. This is a perfect description of Rich's life. Rich held fast to God, but he always had this calm assurance that God was holding fast to him. The command from God to hold fast describes Rich's life well. And it's this reciprocal relationship of holding fast to God and the calm assurance that God is holding fast to us that Rich dedicated his life to teaching all of us in this room and thousands of others to pursue. I believe that the Apostle Paul describes Debach perfectly in Romans 8, 37 to 39, when he says, "No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any power, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Now in our grief, as we celebrate Rich's life and legacy, may we hold fast to God as we trust God is holding fast.
Wow. Thank you for coming. To me, Rich was a little bit Huckleberry Finn and Tom Sawyer wrapped in one. The Huck Finn passion for adventure, the Tom Sawyer and the great ability to draw people into what he, Rich, was doing. Whether it was church youth group, young life, coaching for his kids' sports team, or La Vida, he was always connecting people to the work he was doing, inviting those around him to experience the adventure with him and not just watch it. But it wasn't the Huck Finn or the Sawyer aspect of his life that truly impacted me, but rather his hunger to pursue and know Christ. One of my favorite quotes attributed to Gerald Hardis is, "Ministry is a wake we leave behind as we pursue Jesus." Or to say it like Jesus says it, "Come follow me and I'll make you fishers of men." Our leadership starts with our followership. My friend Rich has left a huge wake in his passionate pursuit of his Lord. I was caught up in that wake in 1982, and I know many of you were also caught up in that wake and have your own stories about how God used Rich to draw you closer to Jesus. But Rich just didn't pursue God, he pursued people. It didn't matter to him if you were rough around the edges or some scraggly kid from Vermont. He would see potential. Potential in the broken and the fearful, calling them, on me, to pursue and trust Christ. And he often had more confidence in these oft-overlooked leaders than they had in themselves. Rich's confidence was based on the reality that God is ever present and uses common vessels to accomplish his extraordinary purposes. He would continue to nudge and affirm, "You can do this, you got this." This confidence was transformative to many as God used it to draw these common vessels to kingdom work. Sounds familiar? Jesus, seeing something in a wee man up in a tree, seeing something in a woman with a checkered past who comes to a well in the heat of the day. Jesus seeing potential in folks who may be overlooked by everybody else. Rich was not perfect and superhuman, but he still had a sense of confidence in others. And I think he needed to be reminded of that himself sometimes. And I believe that's one of the reasons why he loved the book of Joshua, a book that reflected on the need to be strong and courageous, be strong and courageous, be strong and courageous, trusting in the presence of God. A book calling, as we've heard, the Israelites to hold fast and to live wholeheartedly in the grip of God's grace. Rich wanted to constantly remind himself of this need and calling, and in doing so, modeled for me what it looks like to hold on to God as if our lives depended on it, because they do. But not only do we have to hold fast to God, but we have to trust him as he holds fast to us. Rich lived in the grip of that truth, living fully for the great I am. Be here now was more than a phrase or a tagline for Rich. Living wholeheartedly for God while holding fast meant he had to yield to I am. So like Moses responding to the voice calling his name out of a burning bush, Rich was in a constant state of saying, here am I. He wanted to be yielded and used by God. We can learn from this, from Rich, to be here now, not missing what God would have for us in this moment. Rich was one of the most persistent, persevering men I know. He was committed to his Lord, to his family, to his church, to the college, and to La Vida. On La Vida, we use the term commitment move, as you've heard. There's something about challenge that shapes us and grows us. It's not about completion or success as defined by the world. It's deeper than that. It's about learning to walk by faith and hope, in obedience and trust, wholeheartedly committing to I am. Rich so wanted to see character grow in his life, his own life, and wanted to be a mature believer in Christ. But he encouraged us to join him in that pursuit. Perseverance, character, and hope, as Paul mentions in Romans 5, a cord of three strands God uses to grow us in maturity. Maturity that is forged in the crucible of challenge. As James says in his letter, perseverance must finish this work that we may be mature, complete, not lacking anything. This was Rich's desire for his own life. Recently, when preparing groups to go out on trips this past May, he read from the Phillips translations, Colossians 1, 11 through 14. As you live this new life, we pray that you will be strengthened from God's boundless resources, so that you will find yourselves able to pass through any experience and endure it with courage. You will even be able to thank God in the midst of pain and distress because you're privileged to share the lot of those who are living in the light. For we must never forget that he rescued us from the power of darkness and reestablished us in the kingdom of his beloved Son, that is, in the kingdom of light. For it is by his Son alone that we have been redeemed and have had our sins forgiven. While this passage was to set the stage for the trips that headed out this past May, I'm struck and have been struck how appropriate these words have been, at least for me, during this time of grief. This passage calls for us to endure any experience with courage. But so many times this past month, I've not felt very courageous. I go into the office knowing I need to get work done. I just stare at the screen. Yet, I cling to the boundless resources of God. I cling to the reality that Jesus wept. I've been binding myself, holding unswervingly to that truth. This is not a single tear dramatically rolling down Jesus' cheek. He wept. It gives me great comfort that Jesus understands and can identify with our pain, grief, and heartache. He understands, his understanding of grief is one of his boundless resources that I'm clinging to. My Jesus gets it. So as I allow these words, the words of this prayer of Paul's, enrich his prayer and encouragement from the group this past May to dwell in me. I pray that these words will be realized in my life, in our lives, during this time. We need God's boundless resources as we pass through the valley of the shadow of death to be able to thank God for the years we had with Rich, as right now we live in the midst of pain. In Christ we have been rescued and redeemed and are being held fast. As you've heard, nothing can separate us from this tenacious love, not even death. Rich was the ultimate encourager, and the prophetic use of this passage comforts and encourages my soul, and I pray yours as well. It is right that we celebrate what God has done in and through Rich, husband, father, brother, and friend, who is in the arms of Christ being held fast. Catherine Hunter and Tess, Rich, your husband and dad loved you fiercely. And I pray that you be comforted by this image, and that goes the same for the families. To all of us here, may we be encouraged to cling and hold fast to the living God, the great I Am, Rich loved and worshiped and served wholeheartedly. Let me just pray. Father, when we struggle to find words to speak or pray during this time of grief, may the groaning of our hearts, the Holy Spirit within us, utter what we cannot. We thank you for Rich and how you used him to touch and inspire and model for us what it means to live godly, upright lives during this present age. May we trust you as we continue to live on without him in our lives. We will not forget Rich, and we're so grateful that his life constantly pointed to you. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray.
Let's worship God and encourage one another by singing, "Be Still, My Soul." Would you please stand?
Amen.
Well, I suppose it would be a three-volume set, perhaps four volumes of stories if we all collected rich stories together into a set of volumes. Some of those stories would be serious and poignant. Others would be humorous and just downright predictable. As for me, I actually, it was almost 40 years ago that I first met Rich. I was a newly hired hall director from Minnesota, and I had no idea what La Vida was, and it certainly had no idea who Rich Obenschain was. Wandered over to Drew Hall over the Gordon campus over here one day, and I saw about 20 staff working feverishly on various stages of a production line under the diligent guidance of Richard. And my first impression of Rich was that I thought he was the manager and part owner of a decoupage factory. How many of you have one of these in your garage or your basement? Since that time, Rich and I would spend hours together talking shop about our parallel careers of developing educational programs on the outer edges of our respective institutions, La Vida and Gordon College, and then the Ockenghay Institute at the seminary. Here are some additional memories from family and friends of Rich, Tess and Hunter. For years, Catherine and the kids would give a private glance to each other when it came to Rich talking pretty much to anyone. It could be in church, in the neighborhood, or he could be speaking to a gas station attendant. And they would wait for him to start talking, and then they would quietly begin to time how long it would take for him to begin to talk about La Vida. It might be that Rich would simply tell them about what he did at Gordon College, or most often it was letting them know about a specific program that he felt they might benefit from, a father-daughter trip, the adventure camp, compass program, GORP program. He was relentless in his earnest promotion of the ministry he loved so dearly. As they smirked to one another, it was usually about a minute that it took. Catherine tells a story. When Rich and I started dating in 1985, we first met at a Halloween party. He was dressed as a lumberjack, as if that was really a Halloween costume. He didn't exactly put a lot of effort into putting that costume together. At the time, we were both attending Park Street Church in Boston, and Rich was living in what was called the Ware Street community with eight roommates who he had met through the Park Street Church. This group of young working professionals would periodically have a communal meal together, and once or twice a week. Relating to this, Rich told me that he had a lot of specialties when it came to his night to cook. Great. I thought a man who knows his way around the kitchen. By the time we were married, he still hadn't produced any of these specialties. So about a month into our marriage, I asked him, why don't you cook one of these specialties tonight? He sheepishly replied, well, I actually just have one specialty, and it's spaghetti with tofu and peanuts. And needless to say, 34 years of marriage and cooking was not his strength.
Sometimes I have a creative idea or two and love to think about that. When I think about Rich, I think about someone with whom I could never compete. He was an idea machine. If you spent any time with him, he would just be coming up with all sorts of new things for you to do, that we could do. that we all could do, and invite you to be a part of it. I want to read an appreciation for Rich, the family man, written by his sister-in-law, Laurel. Some of the new ideas are in here. Rich was a great role model for us in his prayer life and Bible study. Over the past 34 years, he gave countless heartfelt prayers at our Sunday family dinners. He always asked that God would bless our fellowship together, prayed for those who couldn't be there, and unceasingly directed our thanks back to God. On special days like Thanksgiving, Christmas, and Easter, he set the tone with thoughtful readings and scriptures, which were so appreciated. From the beginning, we could all see how much he loved Catherine. They shared a lot of laughter over the years, often at her standing up to him, which he seemed to love. And he relied heavily on her counsel and was so proud of the strong and wise Christian woman, wife, mother, and therapist that she has become. After many years of praying and waiting, he was beyond happy to become the father to Hunter and Tess. I remember him wearing the newborn identification bracelet so proudly and speedily whisking his and Catherine's long-awaited and prayed-for babies back and forth to the room and nursery while Catherine looked on with a groggy smile. And he could not be any prouder of the strong, kind, hardworking, and talented adults they've developed into. I've always appreciated Rich's modeling of servanthood. Aside from all the evidence of this in both his Levita ministry and the neighborhood and the church communities, we saw it in our own family best. He helped us all with various home projects, for example, building the best and highest tree swing ever for our son Evan when he was young, or spending a day working hard alongside our dad and brothers, cutting down trees on our New Hampshire land. He also brought a lot of fun to our family over the years. A few Easters ago, he rigged up the giant swing in the afternoon so the nieces and nephews could have a thrill. Then he even got our mom, who was 82 years old at the time, to have a go at it. What a quite a sight for us and the onlookers to see, squeals of delight. I'll miss Rich's unexpected statements that seemed to be a part of his makeup and were often hilarious. When our son Evan was 9, kayaking was getting more popular. Rich had bought a couple and he said he'd let us try them out on a beach near the end at Cranes. As the strong current appeared to be sweeping them out rather quickly into the Atlantic, the nervous mother in me yelled, "Evan, listen to everything your Uncle Rich tells you." Rich then turned around and yelled back to me, "I know nothing about kayaking." Psalm 143:8 reads, "Let me hear thy loving kindness in the morning, for I trust in thee. Teach me the way in which I should walk, for to thee I lift my soul." As I picture Rich reading his Bible every morning, I thank him for modeling this prayer for us all, for loving his family so much, for living such an intentional, God-focused life, and for trusting always in him. Well done, Rich. You'll be missed.
Story from Cheryl, sister-in-law. During the first summer that Rich and Catherine are married, they were living at the base camp in New York, and I was staying in their house in Hamilton. I received a phone call from Rich one day and asking me if I would do an errand for him related to Levita. And I said, "Sure, no problem." I thought he was going to ask me to pick up something at the store, but no, this request was as follows. "Cheryl, I need you to get me some cable at the Project Adventure. First, you need to get one of the Gordon College vans in the school so you can put the cable in it. The van is located in the parking lot outside of the gym, and I'll tell you where the key is. It's on the right front tire under the bumper. The combination is Catherine and my anniversary date backwards." So bring the van over to Project Adventure. They know they're coming, you're coming, and one of them, the guys who works there, will help you put the cable in the van. The cable apparently weighed almost 100 pounds. Then drive the van back to Gordon, put the key back where you found it, and someone will drive it to New York. I was thinking to myself, are you kidding me? I completed the task at hand and reported to Rich that all went well, and I was pleased that I was able to help him in that seemingly small way. On another occasion when I was at Rich and Catherine's house, it happened to be April 15th, tax day, Rich asked me when I was heading home to Quincy that evening that if I would drop his taxes off at the Boston post office. And I thought to myself, what? This was before GPSs, and I didn't exactly know where the main post office is in Boston. And Catherine quietly intervened, as she did throughout the years, by saying, do not ask Cheryl to do that. Can I just tell you, Catherine, I can hear the tone. In years to come, the task that I enjoyed doing most for this wonderful family was taking care of Tess and Hunter, picking them up at school, feeding them, tending them in the various ways. The Lord has blessed my life so much through this family.
These next reflections are from one of Rich's brothers, David Obenschain. He writes, my twin brother Dan and I had a typical relationship with Rich that many younger brothers have with their older brother, a love-hate relationship. I know for me that I wanted to be like Richard, my older brother of 5 years, and I think Dan felt the same. Rich was everything all young boys wanted to be, athletic, popular, and good-looking. The problem was that Rich was grown up, and we were just children. He wanted nothing to do with us. When Richard made a decision to follow Jesus, he changed. His focus changed from wanting to only have fun to wanting to serve God with a sincere heart. Rich became interested in our welfare and was most concerned that we also become believers in Jesus. His focus shifted from himself to others, and more importantly, his family. What an incredible, immediate change. It was truly a heart change. God changed him. He was now interested in Dan and I, his little brothers, and sought out our friendship and company. He became a wonderful big brother and a spiritual leader in our family. Because of Rich's interests in spiritual things, a revival started within my extended family. Many of my cousins and aunts and uncles became Christians because of him. Richard and I talked on the phone at least once a week for years. He always asked how I was doing. We frequently discussed when we would all get together. Richard will be greatly missed until we all get together again in heaven. What a day that will be.
Remembrance from Cal, one of Rich's brother-in-laws. One of my favorite memories of Rich is from the first time we were at the house in Ossipee together after he and Catherine were married. While I was always pretty much content to sit on the porch and read books, Rich always had to be doing something. So he convinced us all to go whitewater canoeing on the Saco River. At the put-in above North Conway, Rich gave us 3 minutes of instruction before we started down the river. My main memory of the whitewater part of the trip is that there was a lot of screaming and yelling, and it all seemed to be coming from my canoe. But my strongest memory of the trip was when We reached the flat water part. Needless to say, their canoe was ahead of us. Catherine was in front. She had taken off her life jacket to use as a cushion, was lounging Cleopatra-like, sunning herself with her feet up in the bow and one hand dangling in the water. And Rich was standing in the back of the canoe. And once every few seconds, he'd give a graceful, apparently effortless stroke to keep the canoe moving. Laurel and I together both paddling as hard as we could, with at least two strokes to each one of his, couldn't catch up with him. Finally, we realized we weren't going to make it to where we left our second car, so Rich pulled over to the bank at the foot of the hill and told us the new plan. We'll carry the canoes up to the road. And he'd hitchhiked to the car and drive back to get us. To me, it looked like a quarter of a mile portage up to an 80-degree slope, and my heart sank. And Rich then flipped his canoe over, easily hoisting it on his shoulders, and walked up through the shrub brush to the road at the top of the hill. With me at the bow pulling and Laurel at the stern pushing, and with much huffing and puffing and slipping and sliding, we dragged our canoe up the slope 5 feet at a time. Afterward, we asked Rich how he could so effortlessly stay ahead of us in the canoe while we had such a hard time to keep up. All he said was, "Oh, my canoe probably just had better glide." The fun memory of Rich, when I think of him, my own overwhelming memory is of a man who was a role model. Loved God and served God with gladness and singleness of heart, without guile or pretense.
These next memories are from the perspective of his nephew, Evan Franz, one of his nephews. Just a few memories. Of my six uncles, Rich was definitely the most unique of them. Case in point, my earliest memory of him was on my second trip to Prince Edward Island. Out on the tidal flats, he tied a rope up to Klondike, his golden retriever, and attached it to the inflatable raft I was in. He'd then throw a tennis ball ahead of Klondike, which made him dash forward, pulling me swiftly through the water as if he were a sled dog. It was a blast for four-year-old me, Rich and Klondike, and certainly not something your average uncle would think of doing. As I grew older, I began to notice a pattern when interacting with Rich, a pattern for which I'm very thankful. Talking to him would involve at least one of the following things. One, there was always some new outdoor activity he'd want me to challenge myself with, regardless of whether I thought I was up to it or not. Two, he wanted me to help him with something, despite me only having zero experience with whatever he needed help with. Or three, when telling him about something new I learned or was doing, he would eventually ask me how it could be used for Christ. Points one and two taught my introverted self some desperately needed confidence, while point three puzzled me at first, the first time he asked it. I was 8 years old, and I just told him about reading an illustrated history of World War II. I answered his question, "How could this be used for Christ?" with confused silence. But it was a question I started to ponder, and as I grew in my faith, asked with more regularity. It's one I still ask myself today, and I'm forever grateful to Rich that he could continually challenge me. One final memory of Rich will always bring a smile to my face. It was my fourth trip to Prince Edward Island when I was 11, and Rich, Catherine, Hunter, and Tess drove up in his extremely cool Volkswagen Westphalia camper van. One afternoon, we were driving down to Point Prim Lighthouse from the cottages we were renting. It was a good 3 miles from the cottages to the lighthouse. I was in the passenger seat, and he was alternately letting Hunter and then Tess drive the van. Not seriously drive the van, mind you. They would kneel on his lap and do their best to hurl the car left and right while he kept his hand on the bottom of the wheel to make sure it stayed in the lane. He tilted his seat back just far enough so he could barely see over the dashboard, and any oncoming car would see a 5-year-old kid driving the van haphazardly down the road. At that time, I thought it was just a hilarious prank to the unfortunate oncoming drivers in rural Pinsent, Idaho. And I can't forget the sheer delight Hunter and Tess took driving the van, kneeling in the lap of their dad, who was grinning all the way down the road.
Another nephew, Eric. My uncle Rich was known to encourage people to move out of their comfort zone and to challenge them to find new limits for themselves, big and small. In 2017, I went to the Bahamas with my uncle on a short-term missions trip with our church, with his church. And there I discovered he also liked to challenge himself as well. You can probably guess the summers in the Bahamas are hot and muggy. After working outside all day with my pile of clean clothes and shampoo in hand, I would make my way into the showers to clean off. Walking in, I saw my uncle already taking a shower and doing his best to hide himself behind a flimsy shower curtain. Then I realized that there was no reason for him to hide because behind a shower curtain at all. My uncle Rich was fully clothed, as he had been doing all day, taking a shower, lathering up in soap and shampoo over the top of his clothes, shorts, shirt, and all. Intrigued, entertained, and slightly confused, I asked him sheepishly if he knew he had his clothes on. And he replied that, of course he knew. That he was just doing his laundry for the day. Which almost makes sense, except for the ample packing list that we were given before leaving the US. Uncle Rich then told me how he was challenging himself by only wearing 2 sets of clothes for the entire trip. And in order to do this, he had to take a shower and do his laundry at the same time. After showering, he would then change into his 2nd set of clothes, which he would wear the next day while letting this 1st set dry in the sun. And he would then repeat this cycle each day. True to his word, he did make it through the entire trip using only 2 sets of clothes. What is cool about my uncle Rich is that when I asked why he didn't just put on one of the different cleaner sets of clothes that he had packed, he said if he could survive with only 2 sets of clothes, then that would leave him with more space in his luggage to bring donations for the local church. This memory will always be near to the top of my list of memories, reminding me of my generous, quirky uncle. Challenged me to get outside my comfort zone, show God's constant love to others.
It's a short reflection from Rich's longtime friend, David Hanna. Last week, I rode my motorcycle up to Laconia, New Hampshire. I don't think I'll ever get on my bike again without thinking of Rich. We've done so many things together over the last 28 years. But riding has recently been our favorite thing to do. And as I rode, I pictured him in front of me, flannel shirt flapping in the wind, hiking boots on the foot pegs, his considerable height looking a bit much for the bike. We rode past fields, lakes, trees, and mountains, which were flooded with sunlight. It was all part of the outdoors he loved so much, and it reflected the Creator God he also loved so much. We would have stopped at some point at a vista to take it all in. He would have asked me what the Lord had been teaching me lately. or had an idea for a new project he thought I would be interested in. He would have asked about Lori and the kids, and how he could pray for us, because he cared deeply for us and was always praying. I might have asked if he could take a selfie of us with the beautiful scenery behind us. He would have asked why we should do that. My eyes shifted to the mountains ahead. When I looked back to the road, my image of him was gone, and the road was empty. I was riding alone. But he'll always ride with me in my heart and in the precious memories of my mind, because it was an abundant blessing to share his friendship and to have spent all those years together. He taught me so much, the way he lived his daily life and the impact he had on so many people. I'll cherish his example and dear friendship.
Well, there are many stories that could be told. You hit so many of the subtleties of Rich and captured them really creatively and sincerely and nailed it. Let me start by saying that La Vida was really important to Rich, and we shared 37 years. Even though a lot of my years were in full-time ministry elsewhere, we still were connected through this bond of La Vida. I'm going to start with a memory from Dean Borgman, who was a colleague and friend of Rich, and he shares these memories, these words regarding his memories of Rich from the very beginnings of the La Vida ministry. Dean says, "Way back in the 70s, Rich came up from the southern woods with a passion we needed in our Young Life and Gordon Conwell Youth Ministry program. He and I shared a similar and strong interest in taking young folks into the wilderness, where negative cultural factors could be reversed as a young person faced challenges in God's creation. We both believed that in the wilderness, positive identity and faith might be restored. I had been involved in the beginning of La Vida while serving in Young Life down in New York in the 60s. Later, Rich was going to bring it to the North Shore and Gordon College. I looked up to him as our pillar of strength. We hit it off together with natural ease. Academic institutions can be slow to adopt ideas, but Rich had our Lord's patience and persistence in growing La Vida. He exuded the spirit of that carpenter from Nazareth. It became a life-changing spirit to so many young lives and contagious to all manner of leaders. I sat stunned in silence when Gail told me the news. It just didn't seem possible. The indestructible was gone. The respected and loved buddy is gone. May God's love and eternal haven bring us all together."
As you know, Rich loved to invest in students, and he cared deeply about them, and they cared deeply for him. And I'm going to read a story from one of these students, Taylor Bradford. Rich loved stories, not just sharing his favorite ones from back in the 70s, but also connecting individuals in unique commonalities they shared, whether that be from a night in a lean-to or a commitment move on the rock climb. When I was a participant on La Vida in 2015, Rich belayed me at King Phillips. As we stood on top of the climb, Rich pointed out over the landscape and acknowledged the green mountains directly in front of us. He explained to me that there were over 300 shades of green represented there. And just like that number of shades, there are many different types of people who will make up the communities that we live in. The more we acknowledge the parts that make up the whole, the better we begin to know who God is as Creator and Father. So often we look at such landscapes and just see mountains. We see the rolling hills that are defined by blue skies, and we label them as such. But Rich saw trees. He saw eclectic ecosystems that came alive through the joining of roots and the sheltering shade of neighboring leaves. Rich cared for each person who came in and out of his life. He looked at young people and did not see the fear or insecurities that others might. Instead, he instilled a boldness in each of us and assured us that we had something meaningful to contribute to the world. Prior to leading trips in the Adirondacks, I would often be in the office, almost in tears, as I let nerves get the best of me. Phone in hand, Rich would be on the other end of the line giving advice, listening to fears, and praying with me. It was small actions like this, the comforting voice and willingness to process hard experiences, that encouraged me into community and to constantly chase challenges. Rich embodies what it means to live a life dedicated to prayer. He always asked others how he could pray for them. He fostered a community at work, with friends, and in the trees where people could be honest, knowing that there would be a man in a discovery shirt wanting to walk alongside them in their journey. Rich is one of the only people that I knew who would trust a fiery, redheaded freshman with power tools and wake up absurdly early in the morning with students to pray before school. Rich taught me and so many other students how to walk slowly. He taught me how to take the trail one step at a time in order to listen to the people you're walking with and to love the God who created us all.
Nate, who's been part of the ministry for over 20 years, worked alongside Rich and myself for some of those years, but he has these words to share. Those who know both Rich and I know that we have both similarities, but also some stark contrasts. I tend to favor the ice cream machine in the Adirondacks that only swirls two flavors at a time. That would be Donnelly's, for those who don't know. Where Rich would rather drive a few extra miles into Saranac Lake and grab a cone of crumbs along the Mohawk, I'm assuming that's a flavor, at Stewart's. I prefer to top my burgers with crumbled blue cheese and caramelized onions. Rich, well, if the jar of mayonnaise, Hellman's mayonnaise, was not to be found in the refrigerator, I would certainly hear about it. I've never met another man so passionately about whipped egg whites. All I can say is peanut butter, banana, and mayonnaise sandwiches. You gotta try it. That's what he handed down to me. And I love it. I strive to keep my email box under 10,000 unread messages. I think I talked with Abby a little bit ago. I think it was like 35,000. Rich would never throw out anything, and I guess that applies to his approach to deleting unnecessary emails. In fact, I won't even try to count the times he called me at odd hours of the day asking, Nate, I found insert object here on the side of the road. Do we need it? Most people know me as one who has a place for everything, and Nate does, and likes to keep things very organized. Rich, on the other hand, his approach to organization had something to do with large piles of papers organized by decades. But the shocking thing was, he knew where everything was. It was just in that pile, and he would find it. Running a camp in the 80Ks comes with many challenges, one of them being compliance with all Department of Health regulations. Many of these make complete sense, while others take some convincing of my staff to abide by, sleeping head-toe in tents being one of them. Anyways, Paul Petzl, founder of Knowles, had a saying that Rich was often repeated, and he was quite fond of, rules are for fools. Summer after summer, I would try to convince Rich to use soap to wash dishes rather than just rinsing them with hot water. I was constantly telling him that our leftovers can only be in the refrigerator for so long before we're supposed to get rid of them, the Board of Health regs. Sometimes he would respond bragging about his stomach of steel. Most times he would begrudgingly give in and do as I asked, knowing I was trying my best to run a camp according to the health code and standards of New York State. But one battle that would go on for years was that of Rich's coffee spoon. It seemed nothing irked Rich more than having to grab a clean spoon each time he added sugar into his coffee. So those spoons would just end up staying on the counter in the coffee room, so he could use them again and again. So the process would go like this. Coffee stirred, spoon left. Nate picks up spoon to wash it. Rich wonders where his spoon went. Rich complains a bit about missing spoon, but goes to get another one. Coffee stirred, spoon left, and the cycle continued for years. It was a few years ago that I finally thought he was doing as I asked, bringing his spoon to the kitchen to get washed. But wouldn't you know it? The staff were cleaning up after breakfast one morning, and what did they find behind the coffee machine but a stash of spoons just waiting for Rich's morning coffee? It's funny how those little quirky things that drive us nuts about a person are some of the moments and interactions we miss the most. Although I'll keep washing dishes at base camp, maybe this summer I will more readily grab that jar of mayo when celebration burgers are served to remember my friend Rich.
These are the thoughts from Kate McMillan. Kate works in our Levita office as our office manager, overseeing among many things, our office finances and budgets. And Kate writes, "Rich was my boss for 13 years, my coworker for the past 2 years, and my mentor and friend throughout the whole 15. Rich naturally saw the potential in others and would challenge us to grow and develop our God-given gifts. When I first met him, I worked and played in the woods, but he said, 'Hey, you're good with numbers. Figure this out and get it back to me.' So I grew into becoming the office manager for Levita and found that I enjoyed finding budget solutions to help secure Levita's legacy. Later, after I had 2 kids and an extensive knee surgery, he encouraged me not to forget the woods, but to return and exercise my gifts there. It wasn't always easy or comfortable to work for and with someone who could so clearly see a better version of myself. But I know that I would not be the person I am today had I not met Rich. I realized that most of us could talk about how Rich challenged and encouraged us, but I also want to remind us of something he didn't talk about very much, but that he modeled very well. Rich had a well-honed view of comfort zones. One of the Adventure Camp summer themes that he came up with was, comfort zones are overrated. He would not encourage anyone to reside continuously where they weren't challenged to grow, but he also didn't shun comfort zones. To the contrary, he created them and used them wisely. He used them more like a Sabbath, an intentional time set aside to recharge in order to grow again. One part rest for every 6 parts growth. He was still learning how to use this type of time well. Occasionally, Catherine would be able to convince him to go and actually take a vacation. The first major vacation was a month-long trip to the national parks in the Western Mountain Zone. He worried that work would be left undone and fretted over this before he left. His supervisor, Barry Loy, pretty much encouraged him to see it as a sabbatical. Upon returning, he was brimming with new ideas and programs. We almost worried that he had recharged too much. Ever since then, he was glad for these vacations that Catherine encouraged, even though he readily admitted it took him 2 to 3 days to wind down into vacation mode. Rich was also choosy in where he would find rest in his day-to-day. The Word of God each morning, his beloved family, his small group, his work community, and more. If you ever went to Depot Diner with him, joined in Friday morning prayer breakfast, rode to New Hampshire, New York, the ropes course, or anywhere really, then you experienced this comfort. All of these became sacred places to recharge, regroup, and re-engage. I've been thinking a lot about these wise uses of time and space and community. As I do, I'm so thankful for the memories and the example of how well my mentor and friend used them. It's through the intentional use of such comfort zones that I and others are being taught once again by Rich how best to walk through this present world without him."
I first got to know Matt Loy when he was 12 years old, when he joined Mark Modzelewski and I to go up to the base camp, our newly purchased base camp, to make some quick improvements so the Board of Health would feel better about us being there. After that time, Matt was a pretty regular fixture in our office, popping out in after school, and Rich had a great fondness for him. And Matt, I think he really appreciated you because he saw himself in you. So this is Matt's story. Over the 20 years or so that I knew Rich, he taught me many things, from academic classes, La Vida programs, and mentorship, to cut down trees and how to build a ropes course. He started letting me help him work on the La Vida ropes course when I was about 14 years old. In retrospect, some would say I was too young, but Rich was the kind of guy that believed in introducing young people to new experiences. He was known to sometimes send his children up the flying squirrel out in front of Frost Hall in their car seats. We have both ends of the spectrums, infants and 80-year-old women. These early lessons have shaped the past 20 years of my life and continue to influence me to this day in my work with Project Adventure. I only now realize how much his confidence in me helped to shape my life and career. Rich taught me not only how to build ropes courses, but why we build them. His passion for sharing the outdoors was exceeded only by his desire to share the gospel and encourage others to grow deeper in their relationship with the Lord. Although Rich held a master's in divinity and was known to some as the preacher man, I felt the kernel of Rich's evangelism and discipleship was an outpouring of his personal testimony and life experience. One of the most unique responsibilities Rich ever tasked me with was the weekly refilling of the water cooler, a common responsibility of many office interns. But at the La Vida office, this procedure was anything but typical. If I recall correctly, the water cooler had been purchased at BJ's along with 1 5-gallon bottle of spring water. I'm not sure if BJ's offered a refill service, but as I found out, Rich was running his own refill service. When the water cooler was empty, I was sent to refill it at the hose spigot outside physical plant. Rich advised that I try to be inconspicuous while carrying out the refill procedure, presumably not to draw attention, undue attention to the practice. As many of you know, Rich was never too picky about the water he drank, but when he drank it, it had to be cold. To me and many others, Rich was a follower of Christ, mentor, professor, and friend. I'll be forever grateful to Rich for his generous investment in my life.
This is my personal letter to Rich. Dear Rich, I can't begin to thank you for mentoring me in my life's work. Thank you for finding me in Ecuador 11 years ago and for seeing potential in me that I didn't know I had. It's impossible for me to imagine where I would be without your guidance. You were always there to support me and lift me up to the next adventure, even when I wasn't sure that was the particular adventure I wanted to be on. For instance, there was that time when we were double-heading it on your bicycle over to Lane. I asked you to slow down and you confidently told me that we couldn't because we didn't have any brakes. Sometimes that's what it felt like to do ministry with you. We were doing it together. It was crazy. There was no slowing down, but there was no doubt in your mind that we were going to make it, and we always did. Thank you for being a godly example to me through your commitment to spending time in God's Word. Many mornings in our office, I would see you poring over the scriptures. You would often share with me the insights that God had given you from Old Testament passages. So consistent were you in doing your devotions that you once told me you used to read them to your kids while you drove them to school. When I questioned the thought of you driving and reading at the same time, you casually mentioned that you had a few really close calls and that you probably weren't the best example of a good driver. You may not have been the best example of a good driver, but I can say you were a great example of how to follow Christ. Thank you. Lastly, I want to thank you for your example of servant leadership. for the way you sacrificially gave of your time and energy to serve others. As if you didn't serve enough through your regular work with La Vida, you were always helping friends and family with their personal projects. I remember the time you asked, "Is anyone available the Saturday after Thanksgiving? I'm going to go cut down a tree for a friend. Who wants to join me?" Of course, I don't think any of us responded to that text message, but I'm sure you went ahead and did it on your own. When I think of you, I will always think of Isaiah 58:10 through 12. If you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness. Your night will become like the noonday. The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. You will be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. Your people will rebuild the ancient ruins and will raise up the old age foundations. You will be called the repairer of broken walls, the restorer of streets with dwellings. Thank you for being the living example of the scripture. I am forever grateful, your friend, colleague, and partner in ministry.
Last story from us. I know many of you have your own stories, and certainly I've seen a lot on Facebook, well written, and it would be great to have you send them along to us so we can put them in something. I don't know, I'm making this up, but it'd be great to kind of get them, collate them all together. So I still have my Gordon email, eric.wilder@gordon.edu, if you want to send me your stories, and then we can get them together and share them continually. This is from Mark Stoll, who works at Gordon College. He's been a longtime colleague and partner in ministry with Rich through the Discovery Program. So Mark writes, "It's hard to sit and write this because now I have to deal with it. I keep expecting to turn the corner and see Rich scooting by on his motorcycle or asking me to help him plant a telephone pole out at the ropes course. I'm not sure I'm ready to face all the firsts yet. The first time I have to go to base camp without them, or the first time on the ropes course. You take these for granted until they're gone. I always think the best you can say about someone is that they're real, no frills. What you see is what you get. Most comfortable in Carhartts and a t-shirt. Rich was real. And his legacy here is honestly astounding. Who gets to start a program from scratch in an academic setting like this and climb a tree whenever he wants to? Could you imagine pitching this to academia? Yeah, we're going to be in the woods up a lot, up high in the trees, camping, rock climbing, oh yeah, be alone for 2 days and nights without food. But in classic Rich style, and this is what I loved about this man, he didn't pitch anything, he just lived it, fed it, nursed it along, and apologized for it way too much. And stinking lives changed, including mine in the process. Rich drew out stuff from me I didn't know I had and nurtured it when I'd make excuses. His commonplace, steadfast care and love for La Vida, for his God, and for God's people has made an impact that I'm pretty sure will never completely, that we will never completely comprehend. I was counting the other day, and I've heard Rich introduce Discovery and La Vida to Gordon students close to 50 times. There are always the common themes of holding fast and be here now, but it's also like a journal into Rich's own personal walk with God and what God was teaching him right then. It was so encouraging and refreshing to see him never give up on growing and stretching himself. Sure, I cringed every time he started talking about appropriate things to wear and how to be modest while climbing the wall. These intros were often the only time many students met Rich, and I got a small window into their impression when I had a student confess to me last year. Her first thought of seeing me and Rich stand up in front was looking at the old tree guy. When I asked her if that was me or Rich, she said, "Rich was just the old tree guy. I was the grumpy old tree guy." From my perspective, one of the most powerful things we do, and what Rich taught me and modeled for me, was how to belay. That includes the technical part of it with all the knots and belay devices, but more importantly, the personal part. The closest of standing right in front of somebody, letting them know you really care about for them and take their safety seriously. Talking through their concerns and fears, pushing them, encouraging them to do things they never thought they could do. That was Rich's life and ministry to so many of us. And now we have to go on without him. I can hear him calming us down, laughing a little at our fear and telling us, climb on. I miss you, brother.
Please stand and let us sing together, He Will Hold Me Fast.
Faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, He will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is all and cold, He must hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. Those He saves are His delight. Christ will hold me fast. Precious in His holy sight, He will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last. Bought by Him at such a cost, He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. For my life He bled and died. Christ will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast. Raised with Him to endless life, He will hold me fast. Till our faith is turned to sight, when He comes at last. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. He
We'll sing verses 1, 5, and 6. Would you please stand as we sing together?
Mighty God, now into your hands, we now commend your son, Richard Obenschain, in sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, blessed are those who die in the Lord.
Following the benediction, we'll ask you to please be seated till the conclusion of the postlude and till the family can head out the aisle. We want to invite you to stay and share stories and memories as you're able, as a light reception just outside the chapel. And following the reception, there'll be a prayer walk for those who are able to come. There's a card that you can grab on the way out that will instruct you on how to meet up. And now receive the benediction. And now may the love of the Father, the faithfulness of Jesus the Son, and the comfort of the Holy Spirit fill you with hope as you hold fast to the promises of our matchless, holy, and eternal God. May your lives be a commitment move towards Jesus as we wait with joyful expectation for eternal life with Him, for His glory, and for our good. As we go, let us remember to go in the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.